The Victory Miracle Center presents Dr. John Wiley, sharing the Word of God to people everywhere on the Gospel America Channel, broadcasting to every nation the Word of God. He's running for the Lord, and we are glad you're here. So now, let's join Dr. John Wiley.
Good morning to Victory Miracle Center, where miracles are the believers' way of life. Do not look to the bigness of your situation, your circumstances, nor your trouble. For if you look to those things, the enemy will use those things to defeat you. But rather look to the bigness of your God. And every step you take, and every step you make, God will give you a miracle. This morning, we still going back to our same message today. We're talking about the law of the tongue. Now, we're going to go on a different pathway than what we plan as of right now. But we're going to be in the same message and format. Now, what is a law? The definition of a law is a rule of conduct developed by the governor of society over a certain territory. A law is enforced and controlled by the controlling authority. Laws are set to govern your conduct and your action. They are rules for manifestation or doing business. They are laws set by God, and they are laws set by governing authority of the earth. They are spiritual law, natural law, and we have to use them both to be able to manifest the word of God. In other words, faith works by using these laws. Now, these laws work whether we understand these laws or whether we follow these laws. No matter what, these laws still work. So, in the midst of the law, since we're talking about that, let's deal with the law of the tongue. And it is a law. Because if you don't know how to use your tongue, you can do some damage to yourself and others and situations and circumstances. So let's go right now to the book of James, and we want to dig into this law. Now, we have confirmed to you in the past that this was a law. So now let's go to the book of James, and we'll begin to talk about this. Third chapter, James 3. And the scripture began to reveal to us about this tongue of ours. James 1, 3 chapter, 3rd chapter, verse 1. It says, not many of you should become teachers, self-constituted, sensitive, and reproved of others. My brethren, for you know that we teachers will be judged by a higher standard, and with greater severity than other people. Thus we assume the greater accountability and the more condemnation. Now the first thing addressed here that I want believers to understand, I want preachers to understand, I want teachers to understand, that anyone who teaches the gospel and holds close to the gospel, we're going to be held by a greater standard of accountability. That means that you're not going to be ruled or judged according to just a mere standard of believing. You're going to be held to a greater accountability of what you believe because you're responsible for getting the word out correctly to the people of God. You're responsible for teaching and training and equipping them to, so they can be able to carry out the function and the mission of God concerning these laws and these manifestation of rules. And if we don't do what we're supposed to do, we're going to be judged accordingly, but on a greater severity. That means that we're responsible for teaching people how to do it as we learn ourselves how to do it. So really, if you have not learned how to do it, you're not qualified to teach others how to do it. You can learn in the process of doing others, but you got to know what you're talking about, and you got to know what you're doing. Now, once again, it says here that many of us will not become teachers of others. The reason being is because a lot of us don't want to pay the price it takes to become that great accountability for God. We are servants of the Most High. Now, I want us to go now to the second chapter, verse. Not chapter, we stayed in the third chapter. Verse 2. For we all often stumble and fall and offended in many things. And if anyone does not offend in speech, never says the wrong thing, he is a fully developed character and a perfect man, able to control his whole body and to curb his entire nature. Now notice what he's saying here. He said, any man that learn how to control his words, if you can control your word, you can control your whole life. You can control any part of your life. You can control you, the circumstances around you, the situation that you face. But the only thing you can't control is other people's mind. You can only control yours. And see, that's what we want to deal with right now, because the law of the tongue states that in order for us to be able to manifest the way God wants to manifest in the severity and the higher standard as God wants to manifest, we got to learn this principle. This is a law which I believe you can use as a principle. You can use as a principle to be able to manifest anything you desire in life once you learn this principle. Verse 3. He says, if we set bits in the horse's mouth to make them obey us, we can turn their whole bodies about. Now, he said, if we put a bit in a horse's mouth, we can turn their whole body wherever we want to. It's the same principle with you. If you learn how to control your mouth, you can control every aspect of your life. Verse 4. Likewise, look at ships. Though they are no so great and are driven by rough winds, they are steered by a very small rudder, where the impulse or helmsman determines. Even so, the tongue is a little member, and it can boast a great thing. See how much wood or how much great a forest a tiny spark can set ablaze. Now he's showing you right here about the tongue. He said the tongue is a little member, but it's one of the most powerful things you got on you in the human existence. It's the tongue. It can set a fire ablaze of many things. It can damage. Mm-hmm. It can build. It can strengthen. It can take away life. It can move. It can shock. It can destroy. You name it, the tongue can do it. The Bible say it's a little bit of memory, but yet it have a great impact. It has such a great impact that it can move anything or any existence, any problem, any situation that we face in life, the tongue can move it. See, it's sharing to us that the tongue, that little bit of tongue in your mouth got some power. Say it with yourself. Say it to yourself. Say it with yourself. My tongue has power. So once you realize that, you begin to watch how you use your tongue, because your tongue is one of the most detrimental pieces that God has given you. Matter of fact, your tongue is the key to manifestation, the very life that God has ordained for us to live. It can set a great blaze. It means it can put things on fire. It's like a match. It don't take but one match to set a blaze, and it'll burn your whole neighborhood. It'll destroy your house. It'll destroy your life. It'll destroy your family. It'll destroy anything that gets in its way, even other people. It says, and the tongue is a fire. The tongue is a world of wickedness set among our members, contaminated and depraved the whole body, and setting on fire the wheel of birth, the cycle of man's nature, being itself ignited by hell. The Bible declares right here that the tongue is a world of wickedness, but it don't have to be if you learn how to control it. See, the Bible says that no man can tame it. I'm getting ahead of myself. No man can tame the tongue, but you can control the tongue. So we want you to see, we want you to see here that the tongue is your responsibility. It comes out of your mouth, and we're going to prove to you that God wants you to control it. And if you can't control it, you can't control your life, you can't control your situation, you can't control a situation, you can't control your circumstances, and you won't be able to manifest. The tongue is the very key. Say with me, my tongue is the key to my victory. The Bible says here, it sets on fire the will of birth. That means you can create things with it. You can create life, or you can create death. You can create healing, or you can create deliverance. You can create breakthrough, or you can create unsuccessful lifestyle. You can create anything you desire if you learn this law. This is the law of the tongue. The Bible says in verse 7, every kind of beast and birds or reptiles or sea animal can be tamed and have been tamed by human genius, nature. But the human tongue can be tamed by no man. It is a restless, undisciplined, unconcilable evil, full of deadly poison. With it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse men who were made in God's likeness. The Bible says here, right here, verse 7, verse 8 through 9, 7 through 9. No man can constrain them, no man can tame the human tongue. Said, no man can tame it. If you can't tame it, how in the world are you supposed to be able to manifest the good things of life if it's always evil? If the tongue always going to speak what it wants to speak and to do what it want to do and to say what it want to say, how can you or how can we as a people of God manifest the very thing of the tongue if we can't do anything with it? I don't believe that God was saying that we can't do anything with it, because I went to that and I began to look at some things. But let's keep going for a moment before we get there. Verse 10. Out of the same mouth come forth blessing and cursing. These things, my brethren, ought not to be. Now look what God says here according to the word of God. Out of the same mouth come blessing and cursing. Should not be. He said, you should not have a blessing and a curse in the same mouth. But yet we do. We'll turn around and we'll bless our situation, and then we'll speak against our situation and curse our situation, therefore nullifying the effects of our faith, therefore the manifestation does not produce itself, because we have to learn how to control this thing. Verse 11, does a fountain set forth simultaneously from the same opening, fresh water and bitter? He said, do fresh water came from the same mountain, or the same opening, or the same fountain, fresh and bitter water, the same thing? You can't get no fresh and bitter water. If you do, the fresh water become bitter. Verse 12. Can a fig tree, my brethren, bear olives, or a grapevine figs? Neither can a salt spring furnish fresh water. Now he's telling us something here. He said, a fig tree will not bear olives. That means a fig tree is sweet, olives are bitter. He said, cannot bear it. Why? Because there's two different kinds of product. If we're going to manifest with God, we're going to have to learn how to produce the same kind of product each and every time. We cannot produce two different products at one time. That's why the Bible tells us, so is a man thinking, so is he. Now, I believe that what you begin to say and what you speak begin to control how you think. What you speak control how you think. I don't believe what you think control what you speak, because your speaking have a way to overpower what you think, because the Bible declared that faith come by what? Hearing. As you hear, then you can be able to adjust your mind to what you believe concerning your faith. Now the Bible here says here that sweet things and bitter things shall not come from the same tree. That tree should not be able to produce a bitter fruit and a sweet fruit at the same time. Now it shows us and tells us that the tongue can do what? We share with you that the tongue had power. The tongue can burn. And the tongue can break like a hammer. Now let's go to Jeremiah 23 and let's examine this a little farther. Jeremiah 23rd chapter. We used it before, but it's worth using again. Jeremiah 23, let's go to verse 29. It says, is not my word like fire? And talking about the tongue, because the tongue makes sounds that produce what? Words. Is not my word like fire that consumes all that cannot endure the test? He said, wait a minute, my tongue or my words are so strong, so powerful, that anything getting in the way, if it cannot stand under the power of my tongue, it would not last. And see, then what you have to come to the point, understand, God lives in you as a believer. And your tongue is so strong and so powerful that it can burn off every negativity you want to desire, and it can destroy every positive in your life that you have tried to build if you don't learn how to control this thing. But the Bible declares to us that no man can tame it. But we're going to get there in a moment. Verse 29 again. Is not my word like fire that consumes all that cannot enter the tent, says the Lord? And like a hammer that breaks in pieces the rock of the most stubborn resistance. He said, wait, my tongue is so strong that anything, any hindrance that get in the way, the most stubborn resistance, my tongue can break. So you have to realize within yourself that your tongue is the most powerful thing that God has placed within your arsenal. That is your defense as well as your warrior, is your tongue. And your tongue can create the life that you desire once you learn how to apply the law, control it. What? Not control the law. You can't control the law. You can control you and how you use the law. Remember, the law was set to govern your action and the way you do things and how you manifest. So you can't control it. You can control you to abide by that law, but you can't control the law. Now it states here that God's word would break up the most stubborn resistance. Or your tongue, well, let's use your tongue for instance. Your tongue, by using your word, will break up the most stubborn resistance that life has to throw at you. In other words, everything that Satan tried to throw at you, the Bible declared that no weapon, he did not say the weapon would not be formed, but he said what? It would not prosper. That means that I have the right and ability to cast down every thought that the enemy presses in my mind to be able to get my tongue to speak, because my tongue is the open door of life. My tongue is the gateway that opens the door to the lifestyle that I desire, whether it's successful or whether it's contrary to that success. That your tongue is that doorway. Get this now. Not only Is your tongue the doorway of life for your body, but it's not for your spirit only? It's designed to feed our body. It's designed to nutrish, to nourish our body. It's designed to nourish our spirit and our soul. Now I want you to keep that, word I just said in your mind. Soul, your feelings, your emotion, and your will. Now that's how Satan chooses to work with us. How? Through our mind, appeal to our souls so that he can get that advantage over you. He wants to get advantage over you. So how do he get advantage over you? By calling you to speak what? Word. He wants you to use the law against yourself. He wants you to use the law against your situation that will bring demise to you. Because if you say the wrong words, you will defeat yourself. And that's what Satan plot is on. That's what he plans to do. That is his arsenal of getting you to forfeit your rights. And as long as you don't understand this law, and if you apply this law the wrong way against yourself, you will destroy yourself, and the enemy just sit back and laugh. Why? Because that's what he desired. He desired for you to speak against yourself. He desired for you to use the law in a contrary way that was devised against you. The Bible declares this. We can't walk with God unless we be in agreement with the Word of God. And anytime we speak against the Word of God, which is speaking against ourselves concerning what God said, guess what happened? We just now have disagreed with the Word of God. We have agreed now with the enemy plan, so that for now it opened the door for the enemy to come into our lives and do whatever he wants him to do with us, how he wants to do it. It helps him now to supernaturally charge our lives with failure as we speak failure in circumstances over our lives concerning our feelings and our emotions. The reason why I go back to feelings and emotions, because that's where they come from. It comes out of your feelings, your emotions, your will. And anytime you have not mastered those things, it opens the doors to the enemy because you speak those things against your feelings, will, and emotion. Now, he uses a thought pattern to provoke these things in our mind. That's why this law that God said, do not let this law depart from your mouth. Because as you begin to exercise this law, you begin to notice how you use this law. You begin to notice how you use your words. You begin to notice what you do with your words. And you'll be careful not to take notice of how you act upon your word and accomplish these words in your life. And the more you do it, the more greater you begin to realize that how you're speaking these words to your prosperity, to your success, or to your demise. Now, the Bible says that this tongue, James, let's go there for a moment. Let's go to James. Let's go back to James, third chapter. Let's deal with this because James had something to say concerning this. He said that no man could control James, third chapter. Verse 8, he says, but the human tongue can be tamed by no man. It is a restless, undisciplined, it's evil, full of deadly poison. The Bible says it's restless, It's unstable. It's evil. It's undisciplined. And no man can tame it. But if no man can tame it, how in the world can we get to be able to manifest the lifestyle that God planned for us to manifest and to operate like Him? Is our tongue is the most powerful thing that He gave us. We use our tongue to bring things that we think out of the invisible so they can manifest on the earth. So that means our tongue has the responsibility of bringing an invisible thing out of nowhere and creating those things in our atmosphere. So if we can't control that, if we cannot tame it, what we need to do to be able to manifest? Now look at the word tame. Tame means to reduce from being wild or to domesticate. Domesticate is to bring it to a friendly atmosphere so it can not be wild and long. And we know that the Bible says that no man can tame it, so we understand that you can't bring the tongue to the place where it will be domesticated, where it will live peacefully with you. The tongue will not live peacefully with you. That's why the tongue cannot be tamed. It must be controlled. Control is a different environment than tame, even though they have some similar meanings. Once again, tame, to reduce from being wild or to domesticate, to be subject to cultivation. Now, I can cultivate my tongue. Cultivate means to undergird, to build, to strengthen me so I can learn how to influence it. And I learned something that one with the greater influence have the power to sustain or to control. The one who has a greater power have the right and authority to subdue. Keep going. To bring under control. Wow. It means to bring under. It isn't controlling. It's a bring under what? Control. Bring under control means what? Bring it under subjection to who? To me. That means God has given me the right to take control of every part of me. Now, if you go back to scripture, the Bible says this, that any man who do not offend in word have came to the point where he's a mature man and he's able to control everything around him, his feelings, his emotion, his situation, his circumstances, his life, even the enemy. But if he cannot control his mouth, if he cannot control that little thing right there, if he don't learn how to subdue it, if he don't learn how to bring it under subjection, and if he don't learn how to influence it to the point where it will obey him, he will not be able to manifest the way God desires for us to manifest. Yeah, you'll get little trickles here and there, but mostly you'll get the bad instead of the good. What it means? It means to bring, once again, tame, to bring under control. To deprive. Wow. To deprive the tongue. That means you have the right to not give it the power to do what it's trying to do. You deprive it of its spirit. What you want to do? You want to break the tongue's spirit. How do I do that? Well, we're going to get to that matter in a moment. We have to break its spirit. How we break his spirit? First of all, by humbling it. The Bible says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and do what? Pray. Then he will hear from heaven. And then he will heal the land. The first thing God requires us to do is what? Pray. When you pray, what do you do with your tongue? You give it up. And a lot of us like to talk more than we pray. And see, if you have not learned to master your tongue, it's a bad thing to begin to talk more than you pray. Because I guarantee your tongue gonna get out of the way. He gonna get out of the way where it gonna force you, and it gonna say some things you ain't planning to say because you have learned how to discipline your tongue. We say it says subdue the tongue. Can't tame it. You have to subdue it, and you have to soften it up. Say soft. Soften me. I have to learn how to use my words with tact. You can't just tell people how you feel any way you feel it, like you feel it, because they don't feel it that way. So what you do, you will hurt people and hurt yourself because you will close the door of favor on your life because you have not learned how to use your tongue. See, I'm telling you right now how to use your tongue or how to tame it, because you can't contain it. You can only control it. And if you learn how to use it, that is the way to control it. First of all, you have to learn how to give it up. Give it up. Say with me, I got to give my tongue up. Say, a lot of people don't understand. How do I give it up? By not saying anything. I have to learn how to keep my mouth closed sometimes. Can't just say what you feel, how you feel it, when you feel it, how you feel it. Other folks don't feel it that way. Glory. And a lot of people is not prepared to receive how you got to say it. That's why you got to sweeten it. Do what the Bible say. You got to soften the blow. Can't just say it how you think it. You got to soften the blow. Now, he also used the word, since we're there, he also used the word bright. But we're going to use the word first, control. Do what control mean? To exercise restraint or directing influence over or to have power over. Let's read that again. Control means to exercise restraint. That means I have to learn how to hold back. Even though my mind want to say something because my mind is articulating it, I need to learn how to hold it back. I need to learn how to really think about what I'm getting ready to say before I say it. In other words, you have to have a plan for your word before those words come out. Control means to exercise restraint. When you restrain something, you put a bridle over it. That means you put a control factor there so that it won't allow you to disqualify yourself from manifesting what God has told you to manifest. Because there is a way to disqualify yourself. The Bible says every man run a race, but only one win the prize. That means you can run, and you can run the race fast. But the race don't go to the swift or the strong, but who endures. That means you have to learn how to pace your tongue or to pace yourself in a way that you can get control over every aspect of your life. Now, if you can't control your mouth, you're not going to be able to control your feelings. If you can't control your feelings, you ain't going to be able to control your emotion. If you can't control your emotion, you ain't going to be able to control your financial outcome. And you sure not will be able to control the enemy. And the Bible said that God has given you power over all the power of the enemy. So if he's giving you power, you think you just show up and look good? Think you just show up and look good, the enemy obey? No, he obey words. But those words have to have authority and power. If those words don't have any authority or power with you, it ain't going to have no authority and power with him. Now, we use the word bright. And it's very, very important that we check this, because it's very important for us to learn these words so that we'll know how to be able to go forward and manifest the life we want and control that fire on the inside of us. To bright means to restrain once again. It means to keep in check. If I'm going to keep something in check, that means I got to check it every day. I got to check it all the time. That means I got to be watching over to see what it's trying to do, how it's trying to do it, how it's trying to say it, how it's trying to act, and all those types of things. And if I leave it unchecked, guess what? It will run away with me. It'll set stuff on fire that I don't want set on fire. It'll do things and say things to people that I don't want to be said or do things to people. It will come to things in my life that I never intended for to take place in my life. It will bring devastation and evil upon me. And see, that's what a curse is. A curse is no more than you having an open door with your tongue, calling destruction or calling bad down on yourself. That's what a curse is. And how do we do that? The Bible says blessing and cursing should not come from the same mouth. In other words, it comes from my mouth. See, our action is no more guided than why we, what we say, what we think, and then we react. So the blessing and the cursing comes out of my mouth. The reason why we're blessed is because we speak the blessing. The reason why we're cursed is because we speak cursing. If you learn to speak the blessing and not the cursing, you will experience the life that God planned for us to experience. Once again, bright, controlled, restraint, into check. Now what it means? It means to show hostility or resentment. That means you got to get mad with this man. You have to get to the point where you have to decide, no, you ain't in charge of me. I'm in charge of you. God have given me the rule. He have given me the authority. He told me to subdue you. You don't subdue me. And the only way to do that is you got to get mad with a thing. Because if you don't get mad with it, you won't confront it. And as long as you don't confront a thing, you will never be able to face the problem you cannot confront. You have to be willing to confront it. And a lot of time that takes anger. You have to get mad. See, I'm not talking about an evil anger where you do damage and harm the people. I'm talking about a holy indignation that when things are not going right the way you want them to, you have the desire to put the finger on yourself, to examine yourself and decide, this is not going on any longer. I'm going to step in right now by the power and authority of the Holy Spirit that God gave me, and I'm going to use my divine rights and authority and privileges, and I'm going to fix this thing once and for all. And so you have to get mad with that situation. You have to get to the point where, hey, I'm not putting up with that mess any longer, even though the mess coming from you. And a lot of times that's where the mess comes from. We all try to look at other people and say, okay, I'm looking at your mess. Now what about the mess that you see in your own life? That's the mess you be dealing with or need to be dealing with, because that's where the curse is at. That's where the blessing falls. That's where the failure is at, is on the inside of me. It means to affront one's pride. And see, that's the thing that we don't want to deal with. It's pride. But you know, that thing called pride is the number one destructive animal, a demon, existing man life. Pride. Pride will destroy everything in you, everything on the outside of you, everything around you. And it comes from that word pride. Pride is no more than a high mind. I don't need nothing, I don't need no one, all this kind of stuff. That's pride. Especially by drawing back the head. That means, how do I do this? He said, you draw your head back. That means your head trying to go out and do that head thing. When that head right, you snap that head back and shut that tongue down, close the lips, and that way now, you don't have to be concerned about that. You know how these people talk when they roll their head and they be talking all this stuff and I say what I want to say and do what I want to do. And that's the whole thing right there. It's called control. We don't have to do all that. The Bible never declared for us to do all that. We just need to check our action, check ourselves, check our behavior, check the way we say things, how we say things, how we doing things to accomplish God's will. You can do that at the devil. Glory to God. And it will fix some things. Now we see here that the tongue can burn, the tongue has power, and it can break like a hammer. Now, let's go to Proverbs 18. Proverbs 18. Because this tongue has to abide by the law. Do you allow your tongue to disqualify you? Disqualify me from what? From the blessings of God. Verse 21. 18:21. So we're showing you once again that the power have tongue. The tongue have power. Verse 21. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. It's a death and life is in the power of your what? Tongue. That means that you can create life or you can create death by what? Your tongue. What is the word power there? Once again, I like to use this word. The word power in a lot of places in scripture, not every place in scripture, but the word power comes from the word exousia. It means the right to exercise miracle working power. So now God's saying that your tongue have the right to create life, create death, and your tongue have the right for you to use to exercise miracle working power. That means that you have the right on the inside of you of dealing with your mouth to create any miracle you desire. How do we do it? With our tongue. But not if we can't control it. Not if we can't get to the point of maturity where we decide what our tongue say. We decide how our tongue react. We decide how our life flow by becoming mature in the things of God. You have to decide that. You have to disciple your tongue. You have to discipline your tongue. You're going to have to subdue your tongue. You're going to have to control your tongue. Notice now, it's a tank because you can't domesticate it. But you can watch over and keep it in check every day so it will not get out of hand. And that speaks of your maturity. So anybody that really knows the word of God, mature in the things of God, can sit down for you a few minutes and tell where you're at. By how? By your words. Because your words tell me exactly where you're at in your faith. Amen. So now, as we begin to look at that, we begin to see some things here that are very, very different in the things of God. We begin to see the manifestation of what the word, of what your tongue can produce. Let's go to Matthew 12. The tongue is so powerful that it can create the life you desire. It can create anything in your life that you want. It can bring forth things out of your life. And it can allow doorways to open so that things can come into your life if you don't learn how to use it. 12th chapter, Matthew. Let's start at verse 34. It says, "You offspring of vipers, how can you speak good things when you are evil, wicked? For out of the full of the overflow of the superabundance of your heart, the mouth speak." He said, out of the superabundance of your heart, the mouth speak. He's the reason why these things are coming out of your mouth, because they are in your heart. Reason why these things manifest things that you don't desire, because you have not changed the deposit or what been placed on the image on the inside of you. So if you want to change the fruit, you're going to have to change the tree roots. There's a tree on the inside of you that you got to change the roots of. And you change the root by using your tongue. Keep going. He says, once again, you offspring of the viper. Why do you call them vipers in the very beginning? A viper is no more than a snake. Why? Because he said evil and good shall not come out of the same mouth. So if evil and good come out of the same mouth, you a snake. How can you speak good things when you are evil or wicked? For out of the full of the overflow, the superabundance of the heart, the mouth speak. He said, the reason why you're speaking anything, because it got to the point where it's overflowed. The overflowed abundance of your heart comes out of you. That means you can't keep what's on the inside of you very long. What's on the inside of you going to come out of you. You heard the saying said, it worked from the inside to the outside. In other words, you can't manifest that which is not a part of you. If it's in there, it's going to come out. That's the reason why the manifestation is not what we see and what we want, because we have the wrong image on the inside of us. The image of what? Let's say it like this, what he said. He said, get this snake on the outside of you. If you get this snake on the outside of you, the snake represents evil. He twisted. That means wicked. He disobedient. And it bring pride with it. See, that's the formality of the snake. The snake is no more than a prideful creature. And you know it, what he said when he was in the Garden of Eden. He told Eve, surely you won't die, for you are already. You are already. You are already. You are already. Hear, know, and experience the supernatural ability of God. You won't die if you eat the fruit. But what she didn't understand is that she already had this supernatural power and ability on the inside of her. So what he did was got evil on the inside of her, to thinking that she would not die when God said that she would. And that's the thing when we think. We think that we can just be calmly about our words. We think we can just say things, not really watching all those things. And we cause them damage to our left self, our situation, our circumstances, and it keeping us out of what we want to get to. It keeping us out of our destiny and fulfilling the promise that God promised us. Why? Because we haven't learned how to use this law and manifest the things that God desires for us to manifest, the way He wants to do it. Verse 36. But I tell you, on the day of judgment, men will have to give account for every idol, none operating, none working word they speak. The Bible says here, on the day of judgment, every word that not producing, every word that not manifesting, every word that not producing the life that God told you to produce, you'll be judged for. Now, what we have to look at now, we have to compare our speaking to that scripture and find out if we speak in words that will produce, are those words we speaking will manifest, if those words we speaking will bring the life that God promised. If not, you're going to have to watch over the word, check the word, and bring the word as a suggestion. Cast down the evil word that you've been speaking. Uproot the word and begin to speak God's word. What is God's word? All depends on what you deem God's word as in your situation, your circumstances. Now, I want to keep going. Verse 36. 37. It says, for by your words you will be justified and acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned in sins. He said, by your own word, you'll be either free from prison or you'll put yourself in prison. How? By your words. That means you'll be justified or you'll be acquitted. You'll be condemned or you'll be sentenced. A lot of times we sentence ourselves because of our word. A lot of times we cause our own self to fail because of our word. A lot of times we cause our own self to manifestation that God promised because of our words. Now notice now, we deal with the tongue, but the tongue produces words. Tone creates sound so that word can be manifested. So therefore you have to deal with the tone, because that tone is the thing that creates words in our life. Let's go to Proverbs 12. Well, today, Proverbs 12 chapter. Proverbs 12, 18. It says, Proverbs 12, 18. There are those who speak rashly like the piercing of a sword, but the tongue of the wise bring healing. Say it with me. My tongue bring healing. Now, if there's sickness in your body, if there are sickness in your finances, if your circumstances are sick, the Bible says you can use your tongue to bring healing to these situations. You can use your tongue to bring healing to those circumstances. You can use your tongue to heal anything in your life. If I need some new cartridge, the Bible says your tongue is the answer. If I need some money, my tongue is the answer. I got to learn how to talk it up by using my tongue. I got to learn how to talk by using my tongue. I got to learn how to talk myself into healing. I got to learn how to talk myself into deliverance. I have to learn how to talk myself into breakthrough. By how? Using my tongue. Verse 18 again. It says, there are those who speak rashly. So don't speak rashly. Don't speak quick. Be slow to speak, but quick to answer. Like the piercing of a sword. He said, be slow to speak. He said, there are those who speak rashly, like the piercing of a sword. That means they speak before they think. But the tongue of the wise bring healing. Truthful lips shall be established forever, but a long lying tongue is credited only for a moment. That means a liar, they'll see the word, but that lie going to dissipate very quickly. Why? Because they got to tell one lie to cover up for another lie, and tell another lie to cover up for another lie. Therefore, that lie won't stand very long. Now let's go to Proverbs 16. Let's go to verse 21. I've seen something there that I want to bring to your attention. It says, the wise in heart are called prudent, understanding and knowing, and winsome speech increase learning in both the speaker and the listener. Listen to this now again, verse 21. The wise in heart are called prudent, understanding and knowing. Remember now what I said, the Bible cannot, or God cannot bless you beyond your understanding. And if you're going to do anything for God, or accomplish anything from God, or you use your faith in any given way, you're going to have to come from a point of knowing. You can't guess. You're going to have to know. The Bible said, those that know their God are what? Strong. That means you understand what God wants, understand what God requires, and you give it to him. And then you know. You know what? You know what God wants, you know what God requires, and you do it. Just do it. That is a law. And if you don't buy in that law or work with that law works against you and you disqualify yourself for producing. You need to be able to produce. You need to be able to manifest. And this is the law to do it. But see, I believe that this law is the most crucial law that God placed in your life. Because with this law, this is the law that you create with. We don't get that. We got a message coming forth from that called the law of creation. And with this, God uses and establishes your tongue to be able to create the life that, that you need, that you desire, that you want. In the book of Genesis, God decided that what he wanted and what he did. He created it. How did he create it? With his tongue. The tongue. The tongue, verse 23, same book, Proverbs 16. The mind of the wise instructs his mouth. Notice that. The mind of the wise instructs his mouth and add learning and persuasiveness to his lips. He said, wait a minute. A man, the mind of the wise create or instruct his mouth. Verse 24. Pleasant words are honeycomb, sweet to the mind and healing to the body. It was a pleasant words are honeycomb, sweet to the mind and pleasant to the body. What do you need healing at? What part of your body do you need healing at? Begin to speak your word to yourself, speak your word to others, speak your word to your situation, speak your word to your circumstances, speak your word to your debts, speak your word to your life, and see it now. Your life, if it's bitter, will become sweet. But you got to be consistent at it. You got to move away and do what God wants you to do, regardless of how you feel, regardless of how you think, or regardless of what your tongue has to say at that moment. You're going to have to learn how to control that tongue. How do I control that tongue? Once again, I got to learn how to give that tongue up. Give it up in what? Pray more. Watch over it more. Keep watch on it. Check it out. Really listen to the words we speak and begin to make corresponding action to get our life in line so that we can manifest the thing that God planned for us. Without that, we won't be able to manifest. We won't be able to manifest. Verse 24 again. And I like this. Clever words are as a honeycomb. Now, if you can speak words that are blessed, they ain't plug. And the Bible says stirs up anger. That means it makes the situation worse. But if you use soft word, calm word. Now, we're trying to master that. I don't believe that nobody have efficiently mastered that altogether. But you can work at it every day of your life until you get to the point where you become so influenced by what you say that you watch it over every word that you speak. And that is how we master that. We have to keep ourselves in check. We have to keep our mind in check. We have to keep our thoughts in check. We have to keep our words in check. Why? Because we are the controller of us. God is not going to control you. He gave you the power and the right to control you. The only thing you don't have authority over is other people. But you have the control and authority over yourself. So let's begin to use that authority to manifest the thing that God desires for us to have. We can have anything that God wants us to have. We can do whatever God wants us to do. We can fulfill everything that God wants us to fulfill. And we can accomplish everything that God wants us to do. If we just learn how to be consistent and faithful at using this law, watching over our words, accomplishing it in our lives, and we'll see our family change. We'll see our lives change. We'll see our situation change. We'll see our circumstances change. And matter of fact, you'll see your troubles begin to wane. And you begin to see your life become sweet as a honeycomb. You're listening. And you're watching. Dr. John Wiley. We are the believer's way of life as associated with Victory Miracle Center. You're watching Victory Miracle Center. For we believe that miracles are the believer's way of life. You can step in anytime you choose. Receive your miracle. Receive your healing. Receive your deliverance. Now notice what I said. That your word can bring healing. Your word can heal your bone. Your word can heal your body. Your word can heal your life. Your words can heal every part of you. Everything and every situation that you find yourself in, if you learn how to control and use the law of the tongue, you can be able to get yourself out of anything. You can be able to manifest yourself right out of the problem you have got yourself into. Remember, do not look to the bigness of your situation, your circumstance, or your trouble. Look to the bigness of your God. And every step you take will be a miracle.